for the TV. Welcome, everyone. Hope everybody's doing well this morning. Everybody happy? Can y'all say good morning? That's great. Hello, I'm Jennifer Bryan, Executive Director of the Knightdale Chamber of Commerce, and we're so pleased that you are here this morning for the Emerging Issues Forum. We have a great panelist, a great group of gentlemen here this morning to give you information about the state, the county, and the town. I'm going to start over here. I'm going to introduce them. From your left to right, we have our North Carolina Senator, Dan Blue, and North Carolina House of Representatives, Darren Jackson. Wake County Commissioner Paul Coble, he is our chairman of the Wake County Commissioners, and then our Knightdale Mayor, Russell Killen, and school board member, District 1, and that is Chris Malone. And so, gee, are we not lucky to have all of these gentlemen in the same room together and to be able to hear and learn from them. So if you would, I would like for you to just give them a round of applause. Okay, they are going to really talk about, you know, what's going on within the state, the county, to the town, and all about the place, you know, where we live, we work, we do business. And so it's going to be a great morning. So thank you guys for being here. We do have several additional elected officials here, and I did want to recognize them at this time. Please stand when I call your name, or either wave and just let people know that you're here. From U.S. Senator Richard Burr's office, we have Betty Jo Shepherd and Esther Clark. Thank you. Also, Wake County Commissioner Joe Bryan. Very special person to me. And our Knightdale Town Councilman, Jeff Eddings, James Robertson, I know James is here, Terry Gleason, I saw Terry this morning, and we also have our newly elected Dustin Tripp, who will take office on Monday, so we're glad that you're here as well. We give a very special thank you to our Chamber Champion sponsors of our program this morning, and our platinum sponsors, we have Crescent State Bank and Terry Hodges and Felicia Woodard. Terry's in the back there. Thank you, Terry. Duke Raleigh Hospital is represented by our chamber president, Janet Holiday Cashwell, right up in the front. Brett's Healthcare is represented by Lisa Johnson and Carol Watson. And they are here. Raise your hands, ladies. There they are. Thank you so much. Wake Med Health and Hospitals. Our gold sponsors is Jerry Gower Construction, silver sponsor Carter Printer and Graphics, represented by Regan Register, and I know Regan is here, back in the back there. Thank you, Regan. Hitson and Bumgarner Orthodontist, Dr. Bumgarner is here, yes, and did Brian make it? But Dr. Bumgarner is here, so thank you so much for being a sponsor of today's program. And then Knightdale Medical Partners, Knightdale Family Medicine. So, as always, we thank our sponsors of our events. Our Chamber Champion program is very important to the Chamber. It really helps us throughout the year with our budget to be able to plan. And it's just a good thing for the Chamber and also a good program for our Chamber members because it does give sponsorship throughout the year. And it's just a one-time, you know, little one-stop shop. So it's a good program for all. We recognize our Chamber Board of Directors that are in attendance. Of course, our president, Janet Holiday Cashwell, Duke Raleigh Hospital, June Lee from Black Belt World. I know June's here. There he is, June. Sharon Roberson, right over here, with Snyder Electric. Connie Kerrigan, Smith Devenin Law Firm. Debbie Ergens from Wachovia in the back. Chris Wall, Edward Jones. Eric Erickson with Lizard Webs. Monique Terry with Progress Energy. And Monique is I think she's out in the hall helping. Our chamber ambassadors, Melanie Paul, I believe she's out in the lobby as well. And then also I'd like to recognize our office administrator, Sherry Samuels, and she's standing right there in the back as well. And at this time, our president, President Holiday Cashwell, Of course, we refer to her as our wonderful Janet, and she will begin our program by introducing our guest speakers.
Thank you, Jennifer, and good morning to each of you, and welcome on behalf of the Board of Directors and Duke Riley Hospital. And yes, this is my Duke uniform, in case you're wondering. I'd like to start this morning by introducing Senator Dan Blue. Daniel T. Blue, Jr. currently serves as managing partner of the Blue Stevens and Fellers Law Firm. He represents several individuals and businesses in civil litigation, administrative estate, and public finance matters. Senator Blue earned a BS degree in math from North Carolina Central University in 1970. Thereafter, he attended Duke University School of Law, where he distinguished himself and graduated in 1973. In 1980, Dan was elected to the North Carolina House of Representatives, representing Wake County. After serving 22 years in the House of Representatives, thank you for that service, in 2002, he left the legislature to run for the United States Senate. Dan returned to the House in 2006. In May of 2009, he was selected to fill the Senate seat of the late Senator Vernon Malone and was reelected as NC State Senator in 2010. Senator Blue has been recognized throughout the state and country as one of America's outstanding political leaders, receiving numerous national and state awards, as well as being awarded the Joseph Branch Professionalism Award, the highest honor bestowed by the Wake County Bar Association, and several other awards from statewide lawyers groups. Senator Blue currently serves on the Board of Trustees of Duke University and serves as a corporate member of the Research Triangle Institute. He resides in Raleigh with his wife, the former Edna Earl Smith, who is also a civic and community leader. They have three adult children, all of whom are lawyers, and three granddaughters. Please welcome Senator Dan Blue.
Thank you, Janet. Had I known that my office was going to send all of that, I would have censored it. But let me say good morning to all of you. First, let me tell you that since I come up first, I got to commend Jennifer, and I always do, because she does such a great job for this chamber. Joe, you can go ahead and blush. I mean, you've gotten the benefit of it. Such a great job for this chamber. My Senate district currently, the one that I currently serve, includes Zebulon, Wendell, Knightdale, all of these areas, part of Wake Forest, all of Roseville, part of Raleigh, part of Garner. And so I get the opportunity to interact with chambers, not only in Wake County, not only in my district, but throughout the state. And you're just so richly blessed to have the energy that Jennifer brings to organizing this place. And I really mean that. But let me hit a couple of points this morning. Last night, several of us, we aren't in college anymore, so we didn't stay out and drink late, but some of us were drinking early at a reception for the Greater Raleigh Chamber of Commerce. And the upbeat nature of that gathering sort of, I think, reveals how fortunate we are to live in this area. You know, we're constantly being named the best place to do business, the best place to live. Yesterday, as I was riding to work, they were saying that not only do we compare with middle-sized cities, but when you compare restaurants and you compare the educational institutions and all of that, they were even putting us somewhere, rather, they got us in the same breath that they spoke about New York City, Chicago, and other high-class places. The thing that I thought was very interesting about that, and what I will share with you briefly this morning, is that we are a unique place, but we're a unique place because we have these very good partnerships. We sort of explored partnerships in a way differently than most other folk around the country 50, 60 years ago. First place, that's the reason Research Triangle Park is so successful, because we learned how to put together excellent educational institutions, a great business environment and business interest, as well as government, and mesh those things together to create a region that's probably unparalleled anywhere in the United States. There's some places that would compete with Research Triangle Park, whether you're on the West Coast, whether you're up near Boston. But the region that's been created here over the last 50 years is really unique, and it continues to be so. So as I talk about specific things affecting us from the state level, I look at them from the lenses of someone who resides in the Research Triangle area, who resides here, and get the benefit of that vision that so many people exercised some 50 years ago. Now, why do I say that? Because the one issue that we really have to be concerned about, I think, from a state perspective, to keep the triangle strong, to keep the Knightdale businesses thriving and all of those in Wake County, is the constant attention to what do we do to create jobs. Now, a lot of that is out of our control because of what's happening at the federal level. But the secret that we've learned, I think, is that we have to be constantly focused on the kind of educational opportunities that we create for the people in this region. You know, one of the things that all of us were proud of and all of us talk about is the ability to say that we have one of the biggest school districts in the country. It's now 18th or 19th biggest in the country, and consistently was one of the best performing school districts, still is by some of the late statistics. And we have to work on that. But the other thing that I'd like to hit that we talk about, or at least I talk about in the committees that I serve on in the General Assembly, something that flows from an interview, or at least a question that I think Barack Obama asked Steve Jobs early on. And you know the legendary Jobs had been celebrating for having created 700,000 jobs outside the United States. Steve Jobs and Apple Computer created over 700,000 jobs outside the United States. So the question was, what do we need to do to create, to make you put those jobs in the United States, bring some of them back to the United States? And his answer was very simple. And it's one that it's so logical to us. He said, I tell you what, if you come up with a way to create 30,000 new engineers every year, then you can compete with anybody around the world. You can certainly get the Apple jobs. And so that was simple to me. I said, okay, that's a pretty good prescription by somebody who knows, somebody who's basically taken over all of communication and everything else with what Apple did from the early 90s to the time that Steve Jobs died. And so what I think that we've been talking about that makes sense and that is an issue that will redound to the benefit not only of Knightdale but the entire state is we have to be focused like a laser of doing exactly that kind of thing. Now, in a down economy, it means that we have to be willing to spend money to strengthen the engineering schools in the state. And there are three of them. And so when we talk about new engineering capacity and all of that, it's about creating at least our share of these 30,000 new engineers a year so that America will be competitive against those jobs that Steve Jobs talked about taking in other places of the world. So that's what we focus on. Three other things, and I'm going to sit down and Darren will tell you the rest of it. We've had four special sessions of the General Assembly since we adjourned. When did we adjourn, Darren? In April, May? We've had so many, I forgot. Maybe June. Four special sessions, and we still haven't talked about this job creation, and that's what we ought to be focused on. We had one dealing with same-sex marriage, important, but not the thing that we ought to be focused on as a major policymakers for the state. Of course, we had one dealing with redistricting, and I could talk to you for about a year about that. Getting back to where I started, I said that currently I represent all of Knightdale, Wendell, Zebulon, Roseville. I don't know what my district looks like now, but I think I got jagged edges of Knightdale because it's been split two or three ways. Same thing with Wendell. Same thing with Roseville, same thing with Garner. And I mean, if you look at it sometimes, it looks like a splashed bug against a windshield. So we spent a lot of time doing that. That doesn't create jobs. The other day we were in session, we spent a lot of time debating whether or not that there's racial justice in the way the death penalty is administered. Important, but not the key issues that we ought to be talking about. So we go back into session in 2 months. And again, our focus will be on what do we need to do to give truth to what Jobs said that says that America, and especially North Carolina and the Research Triangle region, which has the ability, is focusing its attention and its resources on creating the kinds of people who will create the new jobs that'll keep us bragging and feeling good like we were last night at the Greater Raleigh Chamber event. That's our challenge. that's what I intend to be involved with, and it all boils down not only to higher education and engineering, but what we do in ensuring that we're going to keep teachers and assistants in the classrooms in Wake County so that these kids are ready to go on to higher education to create the new jobs for the region. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator Blue. Before I present the next panelist, I need to let you know that there is a red Chevy Blazer in the parking lot with the lights on, so if you would like to drive away this morning, you might want to go check that. Our next panelist is Representative Darren Jackson. Representative Jackson is a lifelong resident of Eastern Wake County. He and his wife, Tina, who is a nurse practitioner with Cary Cardiology, live near the Shotwell community outside of Knightdale, along with their three children. Darren attended public elementary and middle schools in Eastern Wake. He also attended East Wake High School and Chapel Hill, UNC Chapel Hill, where he earned a Bachelor of Arts in Political Science. He was a class of 93. Darren then earned his law degree from Duke University. I'm feeling very close to these two guys this morning. And he also passed the bar in 1996. After graduation, Darren began practicing law in Zebulon with the firm now known as Gay & Jackson. Darren enjoys a rather typical small-town general practice with an emphasis on civil litigation. Darren has served as a mentor in the Communities and Schools program at East Wake Middle. He is vice president of the East Wake Education Foundation and has coached numerous sports teams in the last 15 years, youth sports teams. His family is a member of Knightdale United Methodist Church. Darren was appointed to the General Assembly in January of 2009 and was reelected in 2010. He serves on several committees, and I want to share what those are with you. He serves on the Appropriations Committee, including the Subcommittee on Justice and Public Safety. He serves on Banking, on Health and Human Services, including the Subcommittee on Mental Health, the House Select Committee on Extraterritorial Jurisdiction, the House Select Committee on Legacy Costs from the State Health Plan, Pensions, and ESC. He also serves on the Insurance Committee, the Judiciary Committee, including Subcommittee A, Redistricting, and the Driver's Education Requirements Committee. Please welcome Representative Darren Jackson.
Good morning. And I, since you remarked on the two Duke law degrees, I'll tell you that only there'll be a third one you'll read about this morning. But go Heels. I'll share that with you, just so we have our allegiances straight. I always tell people I hate to follow Senator Blue. He always does such a good job talking about things that when I get up here, I never know what I'm supposed to follow up on or add to it. So I'll just kind of talk from the hip, and then hopefully you'll have lots of questions when we're all done. On the special sessions, I had to actually, yesterday when Jennifer sent me an email asking me about updating the biography, I had to look at my committees. And the reason I had to look at them is because I'm on a lot of them, but they don't ever meet. Because we've been talking about a lot of issues, but we're not, haven't really been doing the meat of our business that we generally do during the long session. And that's unfortunate. It's this week, in particular, Senator Blue's chamber did debate a very important bill, the Racial Justice Act. My chamber had already heard that bill several months ago, and so we debated a gas tax cap, which everyone in the chamber knew wasn't going to pass the entire body because the Senate was going home. So we knew it was dead. It was just a political exercise to allow some people to cast a favorable vote so that next year when the elections come, they could say, well, they voted to cap the gas tax, even though everybody knew it wasn't going to pass. We also passed a bill that allows breweries to sell their product on premises. And that was the grand total of our 3 days in Raleigh from the House version. And I don't know what that cost. I've heard estimates of $50,000 a day, So I just look at it as I look at it as basically a teacher and a teacher assistant a day. It's kind of the way I look at it when we analyze these things. And so I don't think much of our special sessions, as you can tell. On the budget, you might have read, I think it was in yesterday's paper, that the budget is above what was expected for the first 4 months of the year, several hundred million dollars, and that's a good thing. The bad thing is we've also had some testimony that our Medicaid budget is about $100 million out of balance. We've had a court order ordering the state to do some things with pre-K education that hasn't been addressed. And we've got some other issues coming up. And none of those have been debated in any of the short sessions. And so the effect of that's going to be either the governor's going to have to step in and balance the budget at some point, or we'll get around to doing that in February or March when there's only a few months left in the fiscal year. And so as business owners, many of you know what it's like. If you have to adjust your budget earlier in the year, it's much easier than if you have to make up all that savings in the last month or two of the year. It's going to be a lot more difficult. I will follow up what Senator Blue spoke about jobs and say that that is one of the most frustrating things that I have found at the General Assembly, is how little control we have over jobs and job plans and things of that nature. It is so much influenced by the federal, what's going on in the country as a whole, the federal budget, the stimulus projects. That especially affects Eastern Wake County, and you probably think to yourself, well, why is that? And the reason for that is that Eastern Wake County is where all the affordable housing is in Wake County. And so we have a large amount of state employees and teachers that live in this area. And so when the state budget is cut and we lay off a lot of state employees, that affects this area more so than a lot of other areas. Of course, if you close a prison out, you know, in Bladen County, that's going to affect that community to a large degree. But when you're just laying off this percentage of this department, this percentage of that department, it really does affect Wake County a lot more than the other counties. And so we've been dealing with that a lot and trying to avoid as many layoffs as we can. You've heard different plans debated about how to do that and whether to raise this tax or let this tax expire. Those debates were had and decided, and so that's happening, and so there've been layoffs, there'll be more layoffs. What concerns me the most is that we are still relying to a large part, and Mr. Malone may speak to it about the county, but the school boards have relied upon a lot of stimulus money to fill holes in their budget. And so that money will be running out this year. And so I don't know where the additional money is going to come or if we're going to cut even more positions. And that'll be something that we'll address not only on the state level but on the county level in the months to come. I think 2012 is going to be a better year than 2011 from the things that I've seen, the economic indicators, but it is still a slow recovery from the recession. I use this analogy a lot in speeches and talks I give. A lot of people talk about the recovery. Usually when you have a recession, you have a bounce coming out of. And I heard an economist, and it might have been Dr. Walden, say this a couple years ago, that they expected this to be more like a Nike swoosh, and be just real small like that. And that's what we're seeing. That's what we're seeing on the state level. That's what you hear a lot of people talk about, concerns about a double-dip recession. It's because we've come out so slow, the word we're going to drop down if there's one big economic shock or anything like that we would drop back down into recession. We don't see that on the state level. We do see a little bit of growth. I believe our sales tax collections for the fourth quarter last year were about even with where we were in per capita in 2004, to let you know, from a revenue standpoint. And that was an improvement over the previous quarters. And so it is improving, but it's a slow improvement. North Carolina's unemployment rate is higher than the country as a whole and is expected to remain that way through at least 2014. So it does seem like it will be a slow recovery. What I would like to see is, following up on Senator Blue's comments, is that we be prepared for the next recession, and that I would like to see our unemployment rate lower than national average. Of course, everybody would like to see that, but I think the way to do that is for the, like Senator Blue talked about, preparing education-wise. And that's not something that you can fix short-term. And so when you've got a short-term hole in the budget, you've got to cut. You've just got to make cuts, and that requires, you know, prioritizing things. Long-term, though, it's my belief the thing that attracts companies to North Carolina is the same thing that attracts people to Wake County and Eastern Wake County, and it's education. And company owners, managers, supervisors, the people who make those decisions, the people who are going to be moving with that company, they want an educated workforce that can do the things they want, but they also want to live in an area where their children can get a great education. So they're looking at for education for their workers, but I think they're also looking personal, from a personal standpoint. And that's what North Carolina can offer with a great K-12 education system and a world-class university system. And so as hard as it is to continue to make those investments in those systems, I believe that that should be our number one priority. Now, again, that doesn't bring a job tomorrow necessarily. It may prevent people from being laid off, so it keeps those jobs in the education system. But it's not something that's going to pay an immediate dividend. But I believe long-term, North Carolina will be the better for it. I think that's why we're at now. And I think 20 years from now, we can be in a much better place if we continue to invest in that type of education. I go to a lot of meetings where they talk about different things. Science, technology, education is very important. My daughter is majoring in, she's at State, and she is majoring in middle school education, science and math. That is where the push is now for our teachers, is to get people, to bring them in from business and industry to teach in these subjects, and to train the people who are now going into education in these subjects, because people see that that's what we need. We need more engineers, more people who are trained to think like that and can adopt to issues that come up in technology, so that people like me can get help setting the clock on their digital clock, you know, getting their cell phone to work properly. You know, I have to ask my children to do so many things for me. It's amazing what, you know, my 9-year-old can do on a computer, and we need to make sure all 9-year-olds are getting those opportunities on computers, because they're going to all need them. They're going to need them in college. They're going to need them in high school. They're going to need them in their everyday job. There was a story on NPR last night about a lady who worked in factories all her life doing welding, and she'd been out of work for 3 years. And the reason for that is there were still welding jobs, but you had to be able to set it up with a computer. So she was going back to the local community college, learning computer and basic computer programming so that she could continue to be a welder. It wasn't that there was no more welding jobs. There were fewer. It was just they were all becoming more automated, and you had to have computers even to do basic skills like welding. I saw the same thing in my father's profession, heating and air conditioning, where he started out and everything was pretty simple. Towards the end, when he retired, you know, you got these manuals with the products, and they had all kinds of electronics, and you had to really know how computers worked to diagnose a problem and fix that. And so it's not just our teachers, and it's not just our business professionals. It's all our workers who are going to need exposure to these things. And the earlier we can get them exposed and trained in high school, community college, for the retraining of our workers who have been laid off, the better off I think our economy will be as a whole. All right. Thank you.
Thank you, Representative Jackson. Our next panelist is Wake County Commissioner Chairman Paul Coble. Commissioner Coble received his BS in Business Administration from Wake Forest University in 76, so in order to give due deference, go Demon Deacons. He earned the RHU designation, which is the Registered Health Underwriter, from Northeastern University in 1992. He's an insurance broker and partner in the Raleigh insurance firm Coble Nicholson & Associates. Paul served on the Raleigh City Council from 1993 to 1999, serving as mayor of Raleigh from 1999 to 2001. He is serving his second term as county commissioner and is presently serving as chairman. He is vice president of the Wake County Taxpayers Association and is on the board of directors for the Wake 200 Club. This is a club that raises financial support for families of fallen EMS, fire, and law enforcement heroes. He is a third generation of Raleigh. He and his wife, Connie, have two grown daughters, Paige and Courtney, and he's about to become a grandpa. So come on up, Grandpa, and share your views with us.
You know, I actually thought that would bother me for a while, being called a grandfather, and I've suddenly realized that's a great thing. I'm pretty excited about it. My youngest daughter married Daniel Evans, the quarterback from NC State, one of four, the quads. Two of them played on the NC State football team. So I am looking forward to having a quarterback in my family, and I was really excited about that, and I found that it's going to be a cheerleader. But I'm prepared, having had two daughters and been awash in a sea of estrogen for 20-some years, I think I can handle it. I appreciate the opportunity to be here. We decided time was going to run a little bit slow, so the mayor and I decided I would just give his comments and mine at the same time. The town of Knightdale apparently has decided they're going to triple your taxes. They're going to downzone all your property, and they're going to give back all the parkland. The county's not going to do any of those things. It's been great. Thank you very much. Listening to the guys from the legislature talk, anytime you're dealing with the county and the city, you're really down a little bit closer to where the real rubber meets the road. We recognize the fact, and have for a couple of years now, that the economy is not doing well. Everybody knows that. I certainly see it in my business, and you see it in yours. It's the rare situation where somebody's doing well in an economy like this. Recognizing that, we've made our number one goal for the last couple of years to maintain the property tax rate where it is. Unfortunately, we reevaluated at the top of the market and then watched the market drop out from beneath us. So in order to try to adjust for that, what we've done is held the tax rate where it is. And then simply try to go back and prioritize our spending so that we do those things that are most important, and things that we have to cut out and change, we simply had to do. We've had to make some hard decisions, but we feel like they're core services that we have to provide. When Darren was talking about the things that bring people to an area, as was mentioned, I was mayor of a very small, insignificant town west of here at one time, and that chamber, small and insignificant as it is, because it doesn't have Jennifer, had come up with a white paper that talked about the three things that you actually do to make a community attractive to people from outside who want to come. And it was very simple. It said you had needed good schools, you needed low taxes, and you needed public safety. And exactly what Darren was just saying is somebody who wants to come here, in essence, wants to know that his children and the children of his workers are going to be well educated. He wants to know that he can afford to live here. It's going to be better than it is where he is currently residing. And he wants to know when he gets here, he's going to be safe. Well, I think we're doing those things in Wake County and each of our towns. I think everybody is attuned to that. And that's the reason that even though the bad news is the economy has been poor, the good news in a lot of ways is that people are still attracted to Wake County, and they want to come here, and they want to be part of this, because no matter how bad it looks here, it's not as bad as it is where they are, and so they're trying to come here. Now, that puts pressure on us, because we are trying to maintain our revenues where they are and not put additional pressure on our taxpayers. We have to find ways to attract people and yet be more efficient in how we spend our dollars. A couple of things that we're trying to do. One, this year we repealed a ordinance that we had that hit home builders. We repealed that. It was relatively small, but the point was we were trying to send the message to the home builders, look, we want you to get to the point you can start building houses again, you can start investing in the community, because if you're not doing that, we can't move forward with our economy. We've looked at other regulations and bureaucracies that we have, and we're trying to cut them out, trying to streamline processes to make it easier, because when you decide you want to invest money in the community, now more than ever is not the time to show up at City Hall or down at the county and find out it's going to take you 5 and 6 months to get through the process. It's time to be able to, we really aren't doing a whole lot, frankly, because there's not a whole lot going on. We ought to open the doors and say, what can we do to get your business open? as quickly as possible so that you can start contributing to the local economy. And so we're trying to find ways to do that, and that's important. The other thing is we need to be able to prove that we are spending the taxpayers' dollars judiciously. And so we're also looking at a couple other things that we can do in conjunction. One thing that we're doing with the school board, we came up with the idea that in looking at what the school board was doing and what we were doing, there were several programs that we did, we both did independently of each other, but turned out they were the exact same programs. In other words, workman's compensation. We have a law office right in the county. We have a county attorney, and he has a practice in the county. He does our workman's comp. Well, we have taken over the workman's comp program for the school system. We've just taken that over and said, look, don't worry about that. On those situations that are local jobs where workman's comp comes into play, we will deal with them. We've got experience. We can do it. It's not going to cost us any more money, and we take that heat off of y'all. We looked at risk management and realized that we both have risk management programs. We're both using the same insurance company. Why not put it together all in one program and save those dollars? And then on real estate closings, we close property all the time to buy land for the county or to buy parkland or whatever. There's no reason for the school board to have to keep a group of lawyers or hire lawyers to do closings when we're already doing them. Why not allow us to do that for you and save those dollars? So we think those are three good opportunities to save some common money. And then the other thing is, and there's no secret about the fact, I'd also like to see us take over the building of the schools. The county ought to build the schools. That's what we do. We want the school board, when we elect school board members, we want them to educate our children. Why would we want them to educate our children and then send them into a meeting and tell them that they need to spend $1 billion in construction and get in that, down into the weeds on how to build a school, construction contracts, and those types of things? They're better off spending their time dealing with assignment plans and educating our kids. Let us deal with the minutia of the construction business. Other reason for that is that we have a AAA credit rating, which is pretty impressive. Not many counties in this country have a AAA credit rating. Well, we do that in spite of the fact that even though we pay for the schools, we don't own them. So we carry the debt, but the school system carries the asset. If the asset sat on our books, think how much stronger our financial situation would be. And as we keep our financial situation strong and we keep the tax rate down, we also keep the interest rate down. And that helps us all the way around. So that's a topic that we'll probably have this year that will continue with the school board. I hope that they will see the wisdom in it and that we can move forward on that. A couple other things just to touch on. In spite of a tough economy, there's some great things that are happening in Wake County. If you have a heart attack in Wake County, you are more likely to survive that event than anywhere else in the country. Our EMS program is incredible, and you may have seen now the blue and yellow cars, striped cars that you see zipping around. Those are advanced paramedics. If something happens to you, you have a cardiac event or something similar, the first responders get there, whether it's the fire department or the EMS, but then they call one of these advanced paramedics, and there's a limited number of them. That's the reason they have the cars, and then they can get anywhere in the county in about 5 to 10 minutes. Well, you think, well, wait a minute, you're slowing down the process of getting me to the hospital because I'm waiting for this guy to show up. Well, actually, that's a good thing, because when he gets there, he knows more about your situation than the guys who first responded, because the guy who first gets there may not have seen a heart attack for 2 or 3 months and had to deal with it. Perhaps his skills aren't quite as sharp as the guy who shows up, and he saw one 3 hours ago. He dealt with one yesterday. He is more experienced. He has been trained better. He has more things that he can do in working through the process. We are saving more lives because of that change, and that's because of Dr. Brent Myers, who is our medical director, who has come up with this program. That and the hypothermia program. Also, if you have a heart attack and they show up, they're going to freeze you. Because we slow down the circulation of your blood, and that lessens the damage that's done to your heart in the process. So that's a great thing. The other challenges that I think we'll have this coming year is that we have a community college that is growing by leaps and bounds. What's the biggest college in the area? It isn't Duke, it isn't State, you know, it ain't Carolina, it's Wake Tech. 64,000 students and growing so fast they can't keep up with multiple campuses. And we will have a challenge in this coming year to find ways to help them expand even more. Because when we go back and we talk about jobs and we talk about opportunities, there are people who are both going through school for the first time and those who are going back and getting new education and new fields so they can go find new jobs. And that's an important element to what we bring to the education field is not only do we deal with the public school system, but we work with Wake Tech, and it's a wonderful program. They are doing some amazing things with that. So there's a lot of good news in the county. We continue to try to spend the dollars as efficiently and effectively as we can. We'll continue to do that until we see an uptick in the economy. We just appreciate the opportunity to be of service to you. If you know of something that we're failing at, let us know. We want to know if you have suggestions or have something that you think we ought to do differently, let us know. We want to take a look at it. That's where our best ideas come from. When citizens simply say, did you know you were doing this way? And lots of times we don't. Or they'll say, well, you know, you could do it differently. We want to know that, because if we do and we can look at it, then we can improve what we're doing. Nobody is doing it so well they can't stand some improvement. So with that, I'll let it go. And now Russell can explain why he's raising your taxes so much.
Thank you, Commissioner Chair Coble. Just think, you may have the first granddaughter to be the female lead on the field, a local collegiate field. That would be excellent. We're a progressive area, so that certainly could happen. Our next panelist is Mayor Russell Killen from Knightdale. Despite the fact that we were told we weren't going to hear from him, we are going to hear from him. He is a graduate of the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill in 1991 and earned his JD in 1994. And just think, when there's a chamber day, it's a Carolina blue sky, not a Duke blue sky. So it's okay to be light blue. He is an attorney with Parker, Poe, Adams, and Bernstein, representing clients in the areas of construction, contract negotiation, dispute resolution, and zoning and land use issues. Russell has served as a member of the Knightdale Town Council from 2003 to 2007. Recently, he was reelected as our mayor, and he has served as mayor since December of 2007. He is currently president of the Wake County Mayors Association. Russell serves on the Wake Education Partnership Executive Committee from 2006. He's served on that committee, and with the NC League of Municipalities Finance and Administration Legislative Committee since 2009. He is married to Kipley, and they have two children, a son, Ryan, and a daughter, Rachel. Knightdale Mayor Russell Killen.
Thank you. It's always a pleasure. I just want to thank Jennifer and Janet in the chamber again. They do such an unbelievable job here in Knightdale. And when you talk to these folks, I mean, we are truly fortunate to have the chamber that we do here in Knightdale, and I hope everybody understands and appreciates that. So thank you all. Commissioner Coble was wrong. We're only doubling your taxes, not tripling your taxes. So he overstated that. I just want you to know that before we get started and want to make that clarification. But it is, yeah, a lot of the stuff that's been said here, it does really kind of encapsulate what's going on. And I want to drill down a little bit more and just talk about Knightdale and where we sit there. And Commissioner Coble hit the nail right on the head. I mean, from a community perspective, what are the things you need? You need good schools. You need to be safe. And you need to have low taxes. You have to have a reasonable tax base. And those things we've addressed and we've got. But in Wake County, we have lots of communities that have that. And so one of the challenges for us as a town and for us as a region is, okay, how do we distinguish ourselves? What's different about the Knightdale community in East Wake County? Because when businesses or when people come here, they have lots of great places they can go live. But at the end of the day, where we want them to choose is here. And we've all chosen here, and we're here, and we know why it's such a great place. But that's what I want to talk a little bit about, is as a community, what are the things that we are doing so that businesses and people choose here? Now, he talked about the fact there's not much building going on. Well, that is true. There's not a lot going on. But I will say, Knightdale's the one community we're getting ready to have a 600, 800 home new subdivision coming with the guys from Preston, the new Myers Lake subdivision, which is the only one going on in Wake County. And when you talk to those folks, what they'll tell you is, well, Knightdale's the next spot. We feel like you guys are in a great spot. We feel like it's the community that's going to grow and going to expand, and that's why we're coming here. And that's a good thing. And the things we've done to get to that spot are the things we need to continue to do. And that's focused on a few things. One is obviously making it a friendly environment for businesses. Two is what I call infrastructure issues. And the infrastructure issues are not just roads, water, and sewer, your classic things. Infrastructure for a town involves more than that when you're competing with other places for people. It involves things like parks. It involves things like programs. It involves things like greenways. It involves, you know, making this a place that people want to come, whether that's the revitalization of downtown, whether it's building the pedestrian bridge across the Neuse River so people can hit greenways. Those are the kind of things that are continue to make us a choice for people and businesses. And those are the kind of things as a council and as a town that we continue to be focused on, in addition to the fundamentals. And the fundamentals, again, being your tax base and public safety, and those things we have to have. So, I mean, everybody knows we've got the new park coming in, and that's great. And it's going to provide us with an amenity that we've never had here before. But the big thing about that is what it's going to do for downtown. I mean, that one of the things we've heard for years, and I've known it, is Knightdale needs that vibrant downtown. We don't have that. We don't have that kind of core that will allow people and businesses a place to go, a place to develop, a place to, you know, go on Friday night and have a concert or go to the theater and then go down and have some place to shop or eat. And that's one of the things that's going to happen. If you drive down First Avenue now, it's looked a little better. But the reason is because we're expanding it. And I don't know how many of you have seen it, but what it's going to look like at the end of the day is we're expanding the road, we're putting in curb and gutter, we're putting in parallel parking all the way from downtown up to where the new park's going and putting in sidewalks on both sides. So when the new park's done, and you've got the new park, and we've got the amphitheater, and we've got those things, we've got the new YMCA coming, and we've got the new community coming in right behind that, all those folks and all of us can go to the park, walk downtown, get a sandwich, come back if there's a theater or something going on, if we're having a play at the park, go to that to create a space. And having that kind of space is really important for a community in recruiting and attracting people and keeping that kind of balanced growth that we want. And that's one of the big things we've been focused on in town, is trying to achieve that and get that. And for us, because of something that we did a few years ago, we're able to do that while maintaining that tax base without increasing it. And the way you do that is you got to save. So what we did 4 years ago is start saving. We started putting 2 cents of our tax revenue aside into a capital improvement fund so we can pay for these things now at a time where construction costs are low, and honestly where we need to create the construction if we can. We can build that, revitalize downtown, and do it all in a way that doesn't burden our businesses or our citizens with additional taxes. And so we're fortunate in that regard. Now, there are still lots of things we got to work on. You know, we need better business recruitment here. We want people to come here. The truth is, nobody's really going anywhere right now. I was talking, I think it was to Commissioner Coble before, saying, you know, we've had some people kind of coming in around the edges talking to us about this, but nobody's been ready to move. But we really believe, and in fact, we're meeting with folks again tomorrow, that when things do start to turn, our community is uniquely situated to land those businesses. We've got the land, we've got the roads, we've got the infrastructure. We're at a place to where I really believe we're going to see some very significant growth over the next 4 or 5 years in jobs in Knightdale, and that is something that is important to us. That is important to us on a number of fronts, obviously creating jobs for our residents, but it creates a tax base for us that allows us to do things, again, within the budget without increasing taxes and provide the kind of services and programs and things that people want. So that is a very good thing for us. And again, I give credit not just us, but to the chamber. I mean, Jennifer does a great job, and the chamber does a great job promoting us out in that broader community, which is very important. So we're in a good spot. We've still got to deal with those things. I will say, and Chris is coming up to talk about it, I mean, schools. We need to stay focused on our schools as a community. You cannot overstate the importance of education and schools to our ability to not just survive, but to thrive as a community. We need to get behind our schools. Our businesses need to be working with our schools. We need to be partnering with our schools. We need to be volunteering in our schools. You know, don't walk around and say we need better schools unless you're the first person in line to go out there and volunteer and help. We need to be involved in our schools and in our communities because we can make a difference. And you're going to see programs like that coming up. One of the things I think you're going to see coming up in the next year, and I see Councilor Roberts and I have talked about it, is a partnership between the faith community, which is very strong here, and Communities and Schools, which is a group that helps serve the students at our schools, to provide a way to get mentors and tutors into our schools to help these children and help the kids, and provide that extra services to our schools in a way that will continue to raise the bar. That's something we can do and have a direct impact on our schools, so we need to be doing this thing. So we've got a lot going on. I'm not going to stand up here and talk any longer about it because I know you guys want to ask some questions, but again, I appreciate the opportunity to come up here, and thank you for having me.
Thank you, Mayor Killen. Our next panelist is Chris Malone, who is Wake County School Board District 1 representative. From 2001 until 2005, he served on the Board of Commissioners of the town of Wake Forest. He also served on the town's planning board and several other advisory boards throughout the years. Chris and Becky Malone have been married for 18 years and have three children in public and charter schools. They are members of Hope Lutheran Church in Wake Forest. Chris has been with G4S Compliance and Investigations in Raleigh for 18 years in several sales and managerial roles. Chris Malone.
Oh, boy. Well, first of all, good morning to everybody. And I also wanted to reiterate, as the last person speaking, thank you to Jennifer Bryan, to the Chamber, to Town of Knightdale, Russell Killen, for this event. It's always a pleasure to come here and speak to everybody. It's nice to see some of the same faces, to know that people are interested in what's going on in the school board and the politics in general. Now, Paul, you got up here and you made some comments about speaking for Russell Killen, but you actually spoke for me, so maybe I can sit down. But I actually had the opportunity years ago to speak on behalf of the town of Wake Forest when I was a commissioner to give a state of the town address. And, you know, it was a very quiet time as far as I was concerned. I basically said that the state of the town was good and said thank you very much and sat down. Somebody actually yelled out, is that it? And I said, that's it. I mean, I did speak for a while, but I'm not going to keep you very long. Everybody here spoke about schools, I think that that reiterates and I think is very profound. It tells us all how important schools are to our future. You know, without a good education, we're not going to develop the leaders that we need. We're not going to have the kind of technological experts we're talking about. Senator Blue, you're talking about engineers. We need more vocational schools. You spoke about the budget, Darren. That situation is going to be a real mess because next year, when we have to do our budget again, we're going to be looking at a whole lot less money. We're going to have to cut for fourth time, maybe the fifth time in a row. Now, I am proud to say that our board has been able to not affect the classroom directly. We've worked on minimizing the administrators. We've streamlined all the institution that we can in order to get it to a place where we can still remain functional. But next year is going to be a real challenge, and I can't tell you where we're going to go with it. But I am concerned, and I hope that this economy does take off. We do need down at the General Assembly to talk about jobs. We need to talk about a number of things that will make this economy work. I'm looking forward to that debate happening. On the county side, you know, we've got a good working relationship with the county, and I'm hoping that with this new majority coming in, and that's going to be one of the big things that I guess everybody has questions on. We're hoping that also stays a positive force. And Russell Killen, Mayor Killen here, spoke to the fact that everybody needs to be involved, and it sounded like the next school board member from District 1. But we have a lot of issues that we're working with right now, but things are going really smoothly right now. Since bringing on Tony Tata, and I know a lot of you people have been, from what I've heard, are impressed with Tony Tata. He's taken the reins. He's been part of that streamlining process. He's found money when we needed money for schools. He found a lot of money for Walnut Creek, and despite all that you hear about Walnut Creek, a lot of money is going into that school. They're getting a lot more resources and a lot more programs than many other schools, so I'm pleased with that. He has done a lot in making sure that the system is following his vision. He's taken a lot of made the atmosphere a better atmosphere on the boardroom. I think that we're working together a little bit better. The processes are cleaner, and it's been a very enjoyable year, I would say. Positive year was going in the right direction. So I think the future is bright for this district. There is student assignment. I know everybody wonders about that. I can't make any promises to where we're going in the future. We're no longer in the majority, but I can say that from some of the conversations I've had behind the scenes, I think that we'll move slowly, and I'm hoping that that is the case. There are competing conversations behind the scenes, as you can imagine, but I've had enough to think that we can do that. And I still think that, you know, with this community schools, neighborhood schools kind of aspect of what we're doing, I think that's going to put you guys in charge as to where your kids go to school. We do have feeder patterns, but those are an alternative, a backstop to you are not making a choice. So long as you make a choice, I think that you'll be happy, generally happy with where you go, and I'm very pleased with that direction as well. We do, as I said, I've referred to it several times, do have a new majority coming on board. It should be interesting. I'm looking forward to it, sort of. We'll see how that works out, and we can promise to continue to work hard on behalf of the people of Wake County and Knightdale. I know in the last 2 years that we had a majority, we were able to do a lot in the way of STEM schools here at Knightdale High and out at East Wake. Collapsing the track at Hodge Road was a separate event than the four that Tony Tata had of a mind to do. I talked to him about that, and we went out there and visited, and I think that was good. We all know about moving the high school to Rollsville High, and we've been trying to get people transfers to schools that they want to go to, get more parental involvement. And I'm really pleased with the general direction. I think that the people in District 1 are a lot happier than they used to be, too. And I want to continue that process. Schools are our future, and we need to make sure that we are involved in education and student assignment. And I actually agree with Commissioner Coble on two things. We ought to be involved, not be involved, in the building of schools, although, because they do have the liabilities and we do have the assets. A separate commission would be all right with me as a middle road kind of thing, but that'd be fine. And I think that the idea that we streamline and put some things in their ballpark along the lines of workers' comp was also a good thing. So we're always looking at finding new ways to save the county money and yet at the same time offer you a great public education. Oh, and by the way, Senator Blue, just came through this week. We jumped two school systems this week. We're now number 16 in the country, so we are a very large school district. And as you know, it's been a raucous couple of years, but I think it's been very informative and very productive, and I'm very excited about where we're going, and thank you very much.
Thank you, Representative Malone. At this time, we'd like to open the floor to questions from those of you assembled here today. And just a couple of rules of engagement for this. We have an excellent system in here for audio, but since this is being televised, it might be a little easier for the panelists if you'll stand and state your question for them. And then I would ask the panelists to return to the podium to answer. And as we go forward with the Q&A, panelists, I'll let you decide who's going to answer first. So at this time, we'd like to open the floor.
Let me answer the question anecdotally, James. First, for my entire adult life, I've been associated with both public and private institutions, especially your higher education. I served on the Duke board for 16 years and chaired that board. And each year we debated where tuition was going, and you know, the cost to attend Duke University now, at least undergraduate school, is north of $52,000-$53,000 a year. And while doing that, at the same time representing the people of North Carolina, there was a provision in our state constitution that says higher education, that is in the University of North Carolina, will be as free as practicable. And so we have managed over the years, and this is really part of what has made us who we are, at the state schools within the triangle. And there are three, NC State, UNC, and North Carolina Central. At the state schools within the triangle, until the last 5 or 6 years, tuition, 8 or 10 years, tuition was basically down in the three-digit range. It was a little bit more, but $3,000-$4,000 was the north end of it. And we had the best higher education system, I believe, in the United States. We eclipsed the New York system, which was the prevalent, predominant system, state system in the 60s, and the California system, which we probably surpassed in the 90s because of the downturn in California. And the way we did it, our universities, now major research universities, were able to raid the faculties of the California system in the 90s, the Illinois system, the New York system. And so once you do that, you create the kind of climate that we have here that thinks of new ways to do things. You know, you get not only the SASs and the Red Hats and the Crees and the various other companies that come out of the labs in this region, and the multiple health-related things that come out of the research at Duke and Chapel Hill primarily. $1 billion a year in research dollars come to the triangle. $1 billion. From federal grants and stuff because of the research nature. And so, but over the last 3 or 4 years, it's really a challenge, not only in higher education, because you read the reports, tuition at both NC State and UNC will go up more than 30% in the short term because of decisions that we've made not to adhere to that constitutional requirement. You know, people several hundred years ago had more vision than we have. North Carolina also has the oldest public university in the United States. Again, because people saw some connection between higher education and the ability to move our population forward. Last point, with respect to even community colleges, you know that the pressure is great, and we have started putting more cost at the community college level. So when somebody is talking about a job that's going to pay $30,000 a year, $34,000 as you said, the thought gets to be, why should I accumulate any debt? I can get a job like that and I don't have to accumulate debt. So we see it in the applications, and we see it in other places where folk just can't see the connection between coming out of school with a $40,000-$50,000 debt to go get a $30,000 or $40,000 a year job. We got to change that mindset because for the good of the region and our kids and grandkids, we got to create a climate so that folk value education and understand that we got to keep pursuing it if we're going to compete around the world.
Just to move this forward and for our viewing public, Jennifer's going to bring a microphone to you so that it's a little clearer for those that are watching.
Thank you. I have another question to piggyback off of that. Again, you know, I've met many folks out here, and they're really struggling. Most recently, I've met a young lady that is having a hard time finding employment. It's not that she's not capable or experienced. She has the work experience, but she fell upon hard times, and she's been unemployed for the last 3 years. Her challenge has been, of course, to be able to pay off her bills. And you can't do that if you don't have a job. And of course, when you go and apply for a job, now businesses have requirements in terms of a background check, which is great, but they also check your credit. Well, you know, in this type of environment with the economy the way that it is, you're gonna have a lot of folks falling into that category. What, if anything, can be done to assist these folks and to aid these folks in being able to move forward to get gainful employment without having to worry about a credit check. And that's for either one of the panelists up here.
Well, we're not,
not all at once.
Councilman, I don't know that I know the answer to that question as far as from a private employer standpoint about doing a credit check and what type of things that can be dictated to private employers from the state level. What the state can do is try to attract companies that will bring the type of jobs that young lady might be interested in applying for, and in the meantime, try to make sure that we don't cut our community colleges and our universities to the point where she can't go back to school and get the necessary training she needs at a reasonable cost, as a cost as free as practical. And hopefully so that she can have the opportunities to find that new job. A lot of the other things that your questions have focused on are really federal issues. I think the first question you had that Senator Blue took had really concerned financial aid. Some of the private universities that you're seeing, not Duke, and not those, but the newer universities, the newer programs, are that have very high tuition rates. Those are only made possible because people can get financial aid. And so to the extent that they're able to get that financial aid, if the federal government is guaranteeing those loans or backing those loans, to the extent that they make it harder, make counseling, mandate what the universities have to provide the students before they take out these $60,000 in loans about their job prospects and the actual placement rates, I think that's how that first part of the question has to be attacked.
You had two questions. I want to address both of them. When I was at Wake Forest, I called my father because it was time to decide what my major was going to be. And I called him up and I said, "Dad, I'm decided what my major is going to be." He said, "That's great, son. You know, that's wonderful. What's it going to be?" I said, "I'm going to be a psychology major." I said, "Man, that's great." He said, that'll do wonderful. He said, "I know that'll be wonderful for you. Here's what I want you to do. Tomorrow morning, I want you to get up. I want you to go down to business school. I want you to change your major. And you can pick one of two. You can be an accounting major or a business major. Either one, I don't care. You call me tomorrow night and you tell me which one you pick. Because I'm not paying for you to go to 8-10 more years of college. When you get out in 4 years, you better be able to make a living because I'm not going to be paying for you anymore." And my point to that is that some of our problem is that government can't answer all the questions. If you're going to spend the kind of money you're going to spend to go to college, you ought to look ahead and see if underwater basket weaving is going to pay something when you get out. And you know what? Some of that is personal choice. That's not a decision the government makes for you. That's personal choice. And if you want to spend your parents' money or your money and become a doctor in underwater basket weaving, you're going to get to live with those choices that you've made. Now, the other question that's coming up, and we've seen this happen in China recently. I don't know if you've seen, but China has started talking about restricting majors because they don't want people taking majors that aren't going to be productive in the economy. They have economic problems just like we do. That's a conversation we're going to have at some point. Now, do we want government telling us what majors we can take? No. If you want to go and be an underwater basket weaver, go right ahead, but understand the consequences of your decision and understand that government has no place buying you out of that choice. You've made that decision, and the good news is that's what Wake Tech is all about. Because when you need to be retrained because you can't find a job being an underwater basket weaver and you want to do something that's constructive in this life and be able to pay your bills, we'll retrain you. And we'll give you a great education. We'll teach you to do something you can do. So, I mean, that to me, to a certain extent, it's about choice. And in life, we all have choices we have to make, and then we have to live with them. And it's not government's role to buy us out of that. As a taxpayer who paid for my two daughters to go to college, I'm not sure I'm excited to watch someone else go to college on a scholarship, i.e. my tax dollars, where I've paid for my children, and now I'm going to pay for them, and they're going to get out and not be productive? If we're going to have that debate, I want to be involved in some of that, because it is unfair to the taxpayers who are actually paying for education to also subsidize other people who are making some bad decisions. So I think that's a conversation we're going to have. And on the second question that you had, James, was how are we going to help that person? Well, there again, the answer is not always government. Lots of times the answer is get government out of the way. Sometimes the best thing government does is nothing at all. We make regulations easier. We make the rules simpler. We get out of the way. We don't hamper businesses when they're trying to move forward, because we have seen money be captured within the business community right now that's not being spent. People have higher profits than they ever had, and we've got people who are complaining that businesses are sitting on profits. They're sitting on profits because government has made it hard for them to spend that money. There's the uncertainty of government, and the regulations have set it so that they don't want to spend that money. If government would get out of the way and let businesses spend that money, feel confident and know that they could spend that money, and they start, then she will find a job, because they will invest and they will open up opportunities and it will be there. But if we continue to think that government can answer every question, that we can pay people not to work and we can pay people to do something on a subsidized basis, we're never going to succeed. We're never going to get this economy going again. We've got to find a way to get business back engaged in the economy, not government. And so my suggestion there is that we find ways to reduce regulation and find ways for business to put the money back into the marketplace. If they do, we'll have jobs.
As Jennifer comes up, I just got to say one thing, because the poll provoked me on one item. One of the most influential people in my life, I mean, of course, my parents, but one of the most influential people in my life probably would have been advised not to do what she did. She became an English teacher. You know, nobody pays you unless you're going overseas to change to teach English. Nobody pays you a whole lot of money for being an English teacher. Nobody pays you for majoring in English and in art. And the other things that don't translate directly to business. So, Paul, I'm sure you didn't mean that we don't have some responsibility to ensure, number one, that we create an environment so that every human being has the ability to develop whatever their God-given potential is. You know, some people are right brain, some people are left brain. And the fact of the matter is, what everybody does counts in toward helping make people a whole person. And sometimes the things that people do aren't as valuable as other things. So I just wanted to say that from an educational standpoint, because I believe that it's just as important to have art teachers, music teachers, English teachers, history teachers, as it is to have very good math teachers. Because the fact of the matter is, I was a math major, I still use my math degree in my whole thought process. But it was those other teachers who convinced me that I ought to go into math and think with the other side of my brain.
I've heard from the panel a big emphasis on how important education is. I do have a college degree from a northern school, the University of Michigan. So I understand its importance, and I am an English and art major who is also an entrepreneur and has been an entrepreneur. Steve Jobs did not go to college. If anybody knows his story, he dropped out because his parents could not afford to put him through school. But he did educate himself. And so I'd like to know, is anything being done on any level? I know the chamber does, but what is being done either in our schools in the K through 12 to help to emphasize how to learn to be an entrepreneur, how to think outside the box and not see that the only path is a government loan to go to a government-funded school to hopefully come out and get a government job, because there has to be a tax base of people that can actually have jobs, create jobs like Steve Jobs did, keep the jobs in the country. So is anything being done to encourage entrepreneurism in the school system? And is there any way we could create a new conversation that the only path to success is through school, because there's many, many people that don't go to college? So that's what's being done is my question.
I'll start with that.
It's actually a great question. And I think it's a conversation we have to have on all levels of government and in the education process, K through 12, college, and any. I think it's very important. But the thing is, I think right now in K through 12, the short answer is no. But the conversations are being had, the questions are being looked at, and I think we're going in a direction where you're going to start to see things begin to happen slowly and then build on it like anything else that you have. And that's what I'm seeing. That's what I'm hearing. There are a lot of schools out there, like the KIPP schools and other schools that are, I call them alternative for lack of a better word. They're doing things a little differently. And we can certainly, and this is part of where the conversation is coming in. This is where some of the ideas are starting to become ingrained in the culture, in the conversation, on the board, and on boards all across the country, and that we need to go ahead and start looking at it differently. Different people learn different ways. The concept of sitting in a classroom with a teacher up front with a blackboard and you're in rows of seats no longer works for everybody. And some more dynamic ways of learning have to be instituted and looked at. And I think that's where we're going, but I would not start by telling you that's where we are.
Let me add one other thing on that, because we do put a lot of effort in this thing at the state level. And even locally, there are a lot. If you look at Centennial Campus, part of the underlying reason for that campus over at NC State is that you create an environment where people can come together happenstance. Now, you can't plan it all. But you can create an environment so that people sort of drift along and find different ideas, because they're at a coffee shop together or various other things like that. So we got the entrepreneurial programs over at NC State. Last week, I think that Mayor Meeker may have indicated that there's a real push to do it in Raleigh. If you want to see entrepreneurship on steroids, you go to the American Tobacco Complex in Durham. That to some degree was brought about by participation primarily with Duke University, with the private sector, and with government, both Durham and state governments. And you're getting new job creation out of that place that blows your mind. And what is happening over there, nobody requires you to be a college graduate or anything else. You just come with an idea. And there are various programs so that you come with an idea. Downtown Raleigh, what's the name of the place by Memorial Auditorium? Sort of an incubator. You come with the idea, and the resources are identified and put together. You get business plans and various other things to try to see whether that idea can take legs. It shocks folk, but small businesses provide more than 90% of the jobs in this country, and they are the ones that are creating the new jobs. So whether it starts with you having an idea in your garage like Steve Jobs or Bill Gates, who didn't graduate from college either. But then they ended up getting people who graduated from college to take those companies to the levels that they went, because you got to have pretty firm disciplines. But I think that we realize from a state perspective that entrepreneurship is where you create new jobs, and small businesses are the ones that are entrepreneurial because they have to force themselves to do it different ways. They don't have the resources. But no, throughout in the community college system, and one of the things I'll say about public schools, I know my kids were in junior achievement in various other ways where the private sector was working with kids in school, trying to teach them stuff about capitalism, entrepreneurship, and stuff like that. But I think it's even more formalized in the public schools, different programs for entrepreneurship and creativity. But at the state level, one of the things that we've had to do is cut back on some of them because they sort of overlapped. There were so many different kinds of programs to promote just the kind of stuff that you were talking about. And Mayor Meeker thinks that us doing, or that the city doing what he's trying to do to create an entrepreneurial climate and a place to make it happen will make Raleigh again be the hotspot for new job creation, because Durham has become not only the hotspot in the triangle, one of the hotspots in the country because of the activity going on in the American Tobacco Complex.
One thing I wanted to, in response to your question, well, two things, I guess, is one is I would like to see more financial literacy taught in our civics classes. And that is something that this past session there was a move away from some testing, and I'm hopeful as we move away from some of those things that other ideas like financial literacy could be taught in some of our civics classes, more so than they are. The second part I want to say is I'm sure that, Mr. Jobe's story is an American success story, but for every one of Mr. Jobe's, there are thousands more who didn't go to college, who didn't end up like him. And I just went through this with my eighth grader. We went to the magnet school fair, and they were asking him, you know, they have specialized schools. It's the early school of health sciences, and they have this and that. Well, and then we've had talk in this county about doing vocational schools for kids who aren't going to college, I think. And what I want to say is, you know, a kid that's 13 years old, it's the rare kid that knows exactly what they want to do with their life at that point. And so it's important to me that we keep all their options open. And so that means that they get a high school education that, should they choose to go to college, has properly prepared them to go to college. That decision that they weren't going to college or that they didn't need a college degree wasn't made by some administrator in ninth grade and they were chosen to be pushed into a vocational program where they could learn to do something with their hands or something like that. I want to make sure that every child, when they graduate from 12th grade, has all those basics that they could apply and be accepted in any university school. If they choose to go to Wake Tech, whether it's to get a two-year degree or whether it's to do their first 2 years, which a big push is now, is to go to technical school like Wake Tech and get 2 years and then transfer over into the one at the university, because it is a way of saving some money. It's a way of working and doing some things, you know, during your first 2 years, whether that first 2 years takes you 2 years or takes you 30 months or 36 months. But the important thing is those choices aren't made, that all your options are open. When you graduate from high school and you become that adult and you become responsible for your choices, I want to make sure that something wasn't decided in eighth grade, that you weren't put in algebra, which is, I know, this thing the school system has been doing, that you were not put in algebra, because the difference of whether or not you're put in algebra or not put in algebra makes a big difference in your high school and your college if you look at, you know, large groups of people. So I want to make sure that choice is not being made for you. And then if you choose to drop out of college and start Apple computers, that's great. But if you choose to, hey, I wanted to, you know what, everywhere I look, they say you need a college degree. Well, I'm qualified to get that college degree.
Good morning. I'm Timothy Lucas. I'm a part of the Wake Tech team. I've heard Wake Tech mentioned. Brother James and I are on that team. Before I get into my comment, I'm a native Knightdale, however you want to say it. Some 42 years ago, my parents moved our family here. And my professional career has taken me all over the United States. But to come back and see the great things that are happening here in my hometown are just phenomenal. So that was my lead-in to my comment. I heard Commissioner Coble say that you're looking at ways to expand on Wake Tech. And I heard the young lady here ask about entrepreneurship. I just so happen to be a corporate trainer in the Business and Industry Services Division, which is an aspect of Wake Tech. And within that Business and Industry Division, we have a Center for Entrepreneurship at our North Campus, which is really focused on helping people become entrepreneurs. Also at the Western Wake campus, which is where James and I reside, we have the Small Business Administration housed there. So there are means and resources for entrepreneurs and for those that are striving to begin businesses. And I wanted to ask Commissioner Coble, specifically, what are some of the ways that you perhaps are thinking that could help Wake Tech expand? And I'm asking that because in the role that I play, we are eager and hungry to go into businesses, corporations, and provide training, whether it's interpersonal skills, leadership skills. In particular, I'm certified to teach methodologies called Six Sigma and Lean Manufacturing, which, if you know anything about processes, it helps companies improve their performance and you know, improve the bottom line. So what thoughts do you have that could help Wake Tech grow even more and also help Wake Tech become well known? Because we feel that we're the best kept secret in the county. And I've heard you speak of the numbers, and they're very accurate because we're almost at 20,000 full-time students, and then that other 44 is continuing ed, which is what I'm a part of. These are typically working adults going back to school to get to take courses to enhance their skills. So can you shed some light on that?
Well, you're right. Wake Tech is in a lot of ways, a great secret that we've kept somehow, but obviously 64,000 people have found it, and so we just need to spread the word a little bit more. It's a great model. We have Dr. Scott as a great leader for that school, and I think the what they're doing is absolutely correct. They're putting campuses in different parts of the county so that it's easier to get to them. They have refocused over the years. Used to be when you talked about technical school, you talked about you're going to go learn how to lay bricks or be a carpenter. Now you go and you're learning the gaming system because gaming is so big, especially in this area for the people who create games. There's a school for culinary skills. Wake Tech has the ability to be very well grounded in the economy and to respond to the economy. So I think there's not an issue of what do they need to do different or how they need to do it in some different fashion. I think Wake Tech just needs to keep doing what they're doing. The model that y'all have is working very well. And I think the real world experience, when you go and you sit down in a classroom with somebody who is not just a professor teaching something, but that professor has actually lived that subject, that's when you really get a great education. Because it's one thing to look at it in a book, it's another thing to have somebody tell you, well, that's what the book says, but guess what? That's not really the way it works. Here's how it works. So actually, I don't have a suggestion other than we have a challenge in Wake County to find the resources to give to Wake Tech so that Dr. Scott and his team, you being one of them, can continue to do the things you're doing because it is a great product that is being provided to the citizens of Wake County. And more people ought to know about it because it is really doing some great things.
Okay, we're going to take time for two more questions because we're really running at a very end, okay? So I've had two people say they wanted to do questions. That's Ann Rollins and also Commissioner Bryan.
Thank you. I wanted to switch gears a little and ask you about our latest data of living in the South and being in the Fat Belt and our obesity epidemic in particular that our children are all going to become diabetics by 2040 if we continue in the same direction. And are there discussions at all of the levels? And I'm encouraged to see that there's a part so that you can make the healthy choice the easy choice. And what the state may be looking at, and that could open a whole can of worms and take us in a different direction, but just kind of your thoughts on helping us with that, because that's a number one issue in the county and the state, and in particular related, since we have pre-K through adults here interested. So.
I can only start with that.
Thank you.
I will tell you there are lots of discussions at the local level going on about that because that's a little bit where the rubber meets the road for us. You talked about our park, and that is one thing to do. And the other thing we're doing is we're actually going to create a community garden out there to have the kids have a place, the elementary schools, to come and have a place and learn how to grow food and grow healthy food. And you know, and it's shown time and time again, if children, you know, grow the food and learn that, they're much more likely to eat in a healthy fashion and do that. And that is something that we really can do. And we talked to here locally about micro farms, you know, the idea of having, you know, good, healthy, local food options for our children that they can get to and for our adults to change some of the habits that we have that go with that. And I think it's incumbent on us at all levels of government to start looking at and doing that and doing those things to create those healthy habits. You know, you want to solve the healthcare crisis? Build healthier kids. You know, get rid of some of the problems that we have now, and it'll help cut off some of the healthcare crisis that we're all going to have to pay for later. And we can do stuff at each level, whether it's providing a place for exercise or providing a place to educate our children about how to grow and eat healthy foods.
Just to add on that real quick, the Wake County Health and Human Services Board, one of their top priorities is the obesity issue, for the exact same reasons the mayor was talking about. It's just an issue that we have to look at and have in the forefront. I would suggest we turn off TV and turn off the games and show up at the gym every now and then, but we've got to change our mindsets if we're going to do something about it. So not that I'm against Southern Fried Chicken or biscuits or anything like that.
I can, I'll second all of that, but I'll also say that at the school system, we are actively working with the food people, the department down there that have healthier diets. And the only thing is we need to find healthier food to taste better because the kids aren't necessarily buying it, and so profits are a little down. But if we can continue to that process, maybe they'll find something they like and maybe that'll help out, but we're certainly committed to that as well.
I wanted to make sure that Mayor Killen had an opportunity to kind of close this out. Congratulations, Russell, on your recent reelection. And I know you mentioned a number of things, but I'd like to really hear what you see the vision for Knightdale over this next term and perhaps future terms as mayor is that you would be having in your goal discussion with your council and staff and where you would see the community moving forward and to spend a few moments, whether it's talk about the Knightdale 100 or other groups and this new initiative which CIS and James is leading as far as how we can get involved and continue to make this a great place to live.
I love a softball question again. Thank you, Joe. I appreciate that. I will take that. And you know, we really have, and I hope you all know that as a council, we're very big on vision and focus. I mean, I firmly believe that unless you know where you're headed, unless you have set your goals, unless you know this place 5, 6, 7 years down the line that you're headed, you have no chance of getting there. And unless you make decisions that are purposely and intentionally designed to take you to that spot, you will not get there. And as a council, we have a great council, and we have been very fortunate, and we have set that. And we set a strategic plan a few years ago, and we call it STAGE, which is safe, transparent, active, green, and engaged. And several of the things you talk about hit on that. The safety, public safety, got to have that. That's the foundation. You know, as far as where we're headed as a community, the transparent stuff is so you can see that. The active stuff is exactly the stuff we just talked about here. It's parks. It's greenways. It's getting people out. It's creating connected neighborhoods through sidewalks so people are looking to get places other than by their cars. We want people to be able to walk and ride bikes around here. That helps build a healthier community, both in body, but you know what? In a community, in your neighbors, when you're out walking around or riding your bikes or at a park with your neighbors, you're spending time with folks, and we're building the kind of community that people want to live in and people want to be a part of. Those things are intentional. I mean, that's what we want to do. The engaged part, having a community with groups like the Knightdale 100, with people that want to be involved at every level, from our youngest child to taking care of our seniors. That's, you know, that's the things we want to promote. And the way we do that is, again, government can't do all that. What we can do is help facilitate that through our citizens, whether it's forming the Knightdale 100, whether it's providing a place for senior citizens to come and gather and exercise. We can help facilitate those things, but having that kind of engaged community, that's really what we're looking for. We want to build a better Knightdale. That's my theme. We want to build a better community. We have a great thing going here. I think everybody feels really good about where we're headed, but for that great thing to continue, you have to be constant and intentional about how you improve it. And so we really feel good about the course we're headed on, and we just want to continue that, making it, you know, making neighbors talk to neighbors, building a closer place, building that place downtown where we have to go and gather as a community and spend time together. Those are kind of the vision we have and the steps we've set in place, and I think it's safe to say that's where we want to continue to head. So thank you, and Jennifer and Janet, thank you again for hosting us.
Once again, we thank our guest panelists very much for taking time out of your day to be here and share your views with us, to take questions from a very participatory audience, and we thank you as an attentive audience as well. Let's give our guest panelists another round of applause. We also thank the town of Knightdale for allowing us to host this forum here this morning. It's a wonderful facility to do that. It allows us to show off this part of Knightdale as well. And we're thankful to East Wake TV for filming this today and for rebroadcasting this. You can catch it several other times between now and the end of the year. You can get it on the link at the Chamber website, and you can also see it every Friday night at 8 p.m. from now through the end of December on Channel 22. So thank you, East Wake TV, for doing that for us today. One PSA that I need to make before I let you go, and that is the Eye-Opener Breakfast featuring Dr. Mike Walden, the economist that we always have come back to Knightdale in January. He will be with us on January the 5th at 7:30 in the morning. I believe it's at Knightdale Seafood and Barbecue. Please go online and register for that. You don't want to miss that event. Dr. Mike has been with us now, I think this is his 17th year coming in January. And we've adopted him in Knightdale, what can I say? We really appreciate his perspective, and he always brings it to us clean and clear, and you'll be missing a treat if you don't join us that morning. Thank you again for attending today's forum, and we wish you a great Chamber day. Have a good day.